Welcome to this special edition of the Today Show, broadcasting live from the main street here in Ballina, River Street, and it very much looks like that this morning, doesn't it? Authorities have this under control. They're just not sure how high the water is going to go. That's the great unknown this morning, but it was enough for SES to warn overnight people to move to higher ground or face the threat from these life-threatening flood waters. We know also in the last 12 hours that the local hospital was evacuated, the Ballina Hospital. That was in darkness, 11 o'clock last night. It took them 4 or 5 hours to move them to the local Catholic school. Up to a metre of flood water is expected to flow into the town centre here. Meantime, in Sydney, we've just had confirmation for everyone living in Sydney, especially along those catchment areas and also the river areas, that the Warragamba Dam has started to spill as the city braces for more severe weather. So that might become a problem when that weather hits, if the water is flowing from the Warragamba Dam down into the river systems, because we know the Warragamba is pretty close to capacity. It's an ongoing emergency here. All these floodwaters are coming from further out to Lismore and then further down south to Corakai, where it joins up the Wilsons River with the Richmond River. Lismore is still in the grips of this. Those floodwaters aren't going anywhere. James Wilson joins us now. James, good morning to you. What's happening?
Well, Carl, as the water slowly but surely starts to recede, the horrors and the damage of this flood event is becoming more and more evident. This is a street on the Bruxner Highway near the main CBD, and you can see the damage done to dozens and dozens of businesses. Carl, to put it in perspective, we drove over here in a boat 2 days ago. The water was up to the badge of the Mercedes-Benz sign, and obviously we're now seeing business owners return to assess the damage. I'm joined by Jack. He's a worker who works at the AGM Air Conditioning Centre. Jack, you've returned today to your work. I mean, you can't really put it into words, can you?
No, it's devastating. Would have lost everything there till 2 in the morning trying to pack it up, but that's all fruitless. But what can you do?
So you obviously made an attempt to put stock and supplies further up, but the water just exceeded all your expectations.
No, I didn't care. No, compared to the 2017 one, it's gone way over that and just lost damn near everything. So, yep,
so. It's horrific, and Carl, we're seeing people like Jack and other workers launching boats, trying to get to their properties further in these floodwaters. Of course, they're going to be assessing the damage and what's left, but at the moment, Carl, there will not be much, and what they do from here and how long it takes to recover is still very much unknown. Carl.
James, it's difficult reporting, isn't it, to talk firsthand with these people. I flew over Lismore yesterday. And to see all those houses under, but also I noticed towards the southern parts of Lismore, the industrial estate there, so there's lots of businesses, lots of factory, lots of storage facilities that you'd have to think are all lost this morning. We'll come back to James shortly as well. Let's skip further north now to the border and the Tweed River. Mia Glover is there. Mia, good morning to you.
Yeah, good morning, Carl. We've just hitched a ride on a boat. We're heading towards Mwilumba and Chindra. As you can see, this is just locals helping locals. All of this stuff that you're seeing here on the boat is donated goods. We've got nappies, we've got toilet rolls, we've got long life milk, everyday essentials that people in Mwilumba and Chindra just don't have access to at the moment. The M1 is still cut off. This is the only way you can get in and out to those areas. We were speaking to some people at the boat ramp just before. They say they just want to go have a look to see what is left of their home. So we are on our way there. We'll be doing this drop, but there are so many more drops like this for groceries, medication, that will continue right throughout the day.
Yeah, look, it's incredible what the locals are doing there. Lots of locals getting their boats and their jet skis out just to deliver those all-important supplies this morning. The SES have warned everyone to be really careful if you're doing that, but thankfully people are standing up and delivering this morning, which is awesome to see. Sylvia Jeffries now joins us from Rocklea, where this monumental cleanup will begin this morning. Sylvia, good morning to you again.
Good morning, Carl. It is going to be huge. We've moved around to Peg Road in Rocklea. This is one of the worst affected corners of Brisbane this morning. Residents are just getting in this morning to see what has been damaged and to begin the very big cleanup ahead. One of those residents is David. He joins me now. David, the water went as high as the basketball ring this time. How does it look inside? What's the cleanup going to involve?
Upstairs is not too bad. It looks like the water has seeped through the floorboards. Downstairs is a bit of a wreck at the moment. We've managed to save all our appliances and stuff. They're all upstairs. For me, being here in 2011 as well, the major thing is just family. The family's safe, which is good. The house we can clean and fix. So, yeah.
The memories and the challenges of 2011 are still very raw for people who went through that. Is that the most challenging thing, aspect of this for you right now?
It will be in the coming days, I guess, and weeks and years, I suppose. We still think back to 2011 of things that we can't find and we've lost and stuff. And, yeah, it's going to be hard.
So. Well, we won't take up any more of your time. You've got a huge cleanup ahead. We appreciate you talking to us, and I'm so sorry for what you're going through and adding to the woes of people in parts of Brisbane like this, parts of southeast Queensland like this, Carl. Looting, unbelievably. One man has already been arrested in Ipswich. There have been several reports of looting across the region. If that is the very worst of humanity at a time like this, though, the very best is the Mud Army. More than 8,000 people have already registered to join that community effort over the coming days. So it will be great to see everyone out and force over the next week.
Beautifully said, Sylvia. The contrast there, perfect. I mean, we can't fathom looting at a time like this, but as you say, it's so good to see the better side of human life as well. Look, fire trucks are moving in here this morning. Got the local fire brigades coming in now. There's a whole bunch of operations that are going on as we go to air this morning. G'day, boys. How are you? Doing a great job. So they'll be moving to a general headquarters for all the operations for all this. The airport's been important for that too, with helicopters flying in and out, ADF helicopters as well as rescue helicopters. Look, I just want to point one thing out, and was a point made by the Bureau of Meteorology, and that is that the river, Sammy, if you can just come around this way, around to the river now, you can see it's on the same level as the township. So once the water started flowing over, it was pretty difficult for the township. And then if we go back out that way to your right, Sammy, and all the way around to the streets, keep coming around. So there's really, the water will just keep flowing out because it's level here. That may keep the water at a reasonable level for authorities to handle. That's what they're hoping this morning. Their only danger is the high tide that is coming. Look, there's a flood. There is potential flood emergencies in Sydney right now on the horizon, given the Warragamba Dam has begun to spill. Gabby Boyle joins us now with the latest information from Sydney. Gabby, good morning.
Carl, this is a real worry, the situation in Sydney this morning. Warragamba Dam has reached capacity and it is spilling over, and we're told by authorities that could last for 2 weeks. Where I'm joining you from this morning, however, is the Hawkesbury River, the Windsor Bridge. And you'll remember last year when it floodwaters reached the edge of that there. And I can tell you in the last couple of hours, that level has really risen here, and it's expected to do that throughout the day with rain forecast right throughout this region. We've got a severe weather warning in place from Newcastle, just north of Sydney, right down to Eden. So the firing line of this system is massive. What to expect if you're living in these areas? Storms, flash flooding and hazardous surf conditions. The advice is don't go anywhere near any of our major waterways because they are expected to swell, and they are expected to swell very quickly. We've already had some road closures across Sydney, including the Wakehurst Parkway and near Narrabeen, the first of which was to close. The flood warnings that are in place, they are for the Upper Nepean area, the Hawkesbury River at Richmond, the Hawkesbury River at Windsor and the Colo River and the Upper Colo area. These are massive areas, Carl, and they are flood weary. It is almost 12 months to the day since these areas were hit hard, hundreds of homes underwater and businesses badly affected. This is the last thing this region needs after getting back on its feet.
How much can people take? How much does this country need to take? Gabby, thank you so much for that. Emergency after emergency. We're running here in Ballina, unfortunately, this morning, and we'll come back here live in a little bit. Back to you in the studio.
Okay, thank you, Carl. Let's turn to other news now. And Ukraine's capital is this morning bracing for the worst, with Russia warning residents that it is preparing to hit targets in Kyiv. Nine correspondent Amelia Adams is in Lviv, Ukraine. Amelia, the capital is under attack.
Yeah, it is, Ali. It certainly seems Moscow has switched strategy to an all-out bombardment of civilian targets, because just in the last hour or so, an apartment, a residential apartment building in the capital has been struck, and that came just hours after a Russian missile took out a TV tower in the capital, killing five people. There is a long convoy of Russian troops and military vehicles right on the outskirts of the city, so very much under siege there as we go to air. While in the northeastern city of Kharkiv, heavy shelling right now, constant explosions lighting up the night sky, and that comes after a Russian rocket was dropped on the city's Freedom Square, killing 10 people. Ukraine's president today made a really powerful plea to be admitted to the European Union. He said that a lot more Ukrainians are going to die in this fight. And meantime, of course, Ali, the humanitarian crisis is growing by the day. We're told more than 600,000 Ukrainians have now fled into neighbouring countries, and half of those are children. Ali.
And just think, Amelia, too, the conditions right now. Like, I mean, you look freezing where you are right now. We've got families, you've got mothers with young children who've been walking days in conditions like this to reach freedom.
Oh, I saw them, Ali, queues and queues of them as we drove past down from the Polish border, walking, driving, as you say, in bitter snow, bitter cold, little children, babies in prams, no food, no luggage. They've left with their kids and that's about it. And when they get there, can I tell you, UNICEF's telling me today there's a big problem with sanitation services. The demand is simply not meeting up with supply. So they're going to need a lot of help for a long time.
A big crisis there. Thanks, Amelia.
And fathers staying behind to fight while they say goodbye to their families. It's just awful. In more breaking news, the Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, has tested positive to COVID. He is experiencing flu-like symptoms and is isolating in Sydney. Mr. Morrison says he will continue his duties from home.